And it goes on. Thank you for letting us be ourselves. So don't mind me if I repeat myself. These simple lines be good for your health. To keep them crime rhymes on the shelf. Live my life like I just don't care. 5,000 leaders never scared.
As a ghost, put on some scary music and give a small child a dangerously large amount of sugar. It's Friday, we're live, and it's time for the last leg. Tonight on the show, we do our best to cover Calais, play trick or treat with Trump, and Vladimir Putin gives us a fright. Plus, we'll be joined on the couch by comedian Roisin Conaty and broadcaster Jeremy Paxman on the show that is absolutely smashing. I'm Adam Hills and welcome to the last leg of the show that breaks the news then tries to put it back together again. With me on the couch as always are the pride of Dartmoor, Josh Widdicombe, and the man who thinks a cross trainer is what you get when you cancel your gym instructor at the last minute, Alex Brooker. Now, it's fair to say since the Paralympics we have all been trying to get fit in our own different ways.
Yeah, my unfitness sunk to a new low this week. Yep. On Monday, I went to go and take my car in to get it serviced. Yep. I thought I'd walk the 2 miles back. Yep. I was so sweaty, it was ridiculous. And then it dawned on me I'd have to walk back to the garage to go and get it later on that day. So what I've done is I've taken a towel with me and put my gym gear on, started walking back, inevitably got horrendously sweaty, and then just as I've turned the corner to the garage, broke into a jog. I just got to him, sorry, mate, I'll just... You know, it's like when you go for a run.
I don't know why I care so much.
You turning up sweaty at their workplace, like the worst Diet Coke break of all time.
I don't know why I care so much what the car man thinks. It's not like social services. Who cares if I'm sweaty? It's not like he's not going to hand over the car because I'm too sweaty to look after it.
Well, the irony is, being a mechanic, he probably lied to you about how much work he just did as well. Now, last week on Stand Up To Cancer, I put my shaved Union Jack hair up for auction with all proceeds going to Cancer
auction.
Research UK. Sorry?
Auction.
Auction. I'm sorry.
I know it's for a good cause, mate, but it's an auction, yeah. Please.
We haven't had one of them in series. Oh, I'm really excited to have corrected you.
The winning bid was $400.
This is actually now more than £400 with the strength of the pounds.
The winning bid was £400. It didn't come from a single person. It was a joint bid.
Yeah.
And let's be fair. If someone's paying 400 quid for my hair at 10 o'clock on a Friday night, joint is exactly the right word to describe it.
It was a joint bid. It was me and Alex, and we've got a plan. We're going to go to crime scenes and just sprinkle your hair as DNA. And then I'm going to get one foot, one shoe, and just do it like that. So it's like you've walked up.
The weird thing is I'm going to keep the beard for a little bit, though, because when I got my hair cut, the hairdresser said to me, she shaved my head and then went, oh, you better keep the stubble, otherwise you're going to look like an egghead.
Which one, Daphne or CJ?
I literally have no idea what that means.
Neither did the audience.
I really want you to grow the beard quite long, so you look like one of those optical illusions where if you turn the face upside down, it's still a face.
As always, we will do our best to answer your big questions this week. You can tweet them to us at the last leg and use the hashtag #IsItOK. For example, is it okay that last weekend on X Factor, the wheel that randomly decided the theme for this week's Halloween show somehow did this?
Could it be Louis Lumps? Let's find out. Give it a spin.
Okay. Here we go. Disco 80s. Oh no! Is it?
Let me assure you, that is so nonky, it's 100% bona fide.
Oh, I mean, what are the odds of that happening?
They all look surprised apart from Sharon Osbourne, who couldn't move her face.
I don't want to know what Louis loves.
I want to watch that week.
Is it OK, then, we're going to use exactly the same method to pick the big story of the week?
Yes.
All right, let's fire it up.
Arsenal, the bake-off.
Oh, no. Yes, come on, come on, come on!
There we go. Come on. That's the money shot.
What a surprise. Who saw that one coming? Rebecca said, is it OK to ask children...
That was such a weird feature, sorry.
And the weirder the disappointment before we're about to talk about this subject doesn't help.
Yeah, I mean, let's be honest, we just went, oh, please be food, please be food. No, it's refugees. Right.
I was hoping it was Nando's so we could finally work out what macho peas really are.
Rebecca said, is it OK to ask children from the Calais jungle to prove they're under 18? Now, the refugee camp known as the jungle was officially dismantled this week, hopefully bringing to an end the desperate conditions in which some people were living. While adults were resettled elsewhere in France, some children were allowed into the UK, but only if they were under 18, which begs the question, how can you tell if a refugee from a war zone is under 18? You can't just text them and wait to see if they answer with emojis or walk through the camp with tickets to Zayn Malik and see who bites.
It's weird, isn't it? It's a horrible story, and it's like, it feels like, I know that you've got to have a kind of, you can't just, you know, you've got to have these rules, and you've got to let people in, you can't just have everyone coming in, etc. But, like, it just feels like a strange way that you just draw, like, it's a bit like, you know, you can't just do it like a roller coaster, can you? You can't just have a picture of Theresa May with her finger out going, you've got to be lower than that to come into Britain.
I think there's only, you know, there was the whole thing about, you know, checking their teeth to see how old they are. I think there's only one definite way you can check to see if somebody's over 18 or not. It's scientifically proven. It's been used on many an adult site. Just have a little option. Are you over 18? Yes or no. And no one's ever lied on those.
Why has no one thought of that? Look, many of the children have been resettled in Devon, although if they are looking for accommodation, I'm pretty sure the BBC have a massive tent in Berkshire that's been empty since Wednesday.
Devon, exciting for me that we're in the news at last for the first time ever. There's people kind of saying that are the Syrians going to fit in with kind of the culture in Devon? And it depends on whether in Syria you have your jam or your cream on top of the scone first. But, like, I grew up in Devon and I was a teenager complaining nothing was going on, it was boring. If anything, the Syrians are going to go, that is fucking the best case scenario.
Some press outlets had a field day with headlines that included jungle Nazis, Calais clear out chaos, and migrant madness.
Migrant madness? Kind of sounds like a special show you'd have on a comet.
Well, all this weekend?
All this weekend, it's migrant madness.
One story claimed that a migrant foster mum discovered the 12-year-old refugee in her care was actually a 21-year-old jihadi. Now, here are the facts. She apparently became suspicious when she noticed how hairy he was, then became more suspicious when she saw how quickly he shimmied up the ropes at a climbing centre. But the final straw came when she took him to a shooting range and he stripped the rifle before firing it.
I've got a few issues with this story. The main one being, obviously, you know, she thinks he's a jihadi, but if you've got a 12-year-old refugee from a war-torn country, what are you doing taking him to a shooting range anyway? So this Sunday we're going to give you a flashback. It's just... And also, what were they doing the rest of the time when he was at dinner shouting, death to the West?
It was when they were watching The Hurt Locker and he was supporting the baddies.
I mean, do we think this story is bullshit? Should I hit the button?
Yeah.
Bullshit.
Socialist Steve said, is it OK that the Sun... I mean, who would have thought a guy called Socialist Steve is criticising the Sun?
I might be Socialist Steve 7, as if it's really taking off now. There's seven of them.
Is it OK the Sun is calling for Gary Lineker to be sacked for showing he's a decent human being? Now, football presenter... If you don't know, football presenter and crisp promoter Gary Lineker tweeted... I'm from Australia, that's all I know him for. The treatment by some towards these young refugees is hideously racist and utterly heartless. What's happening to our country is what he said. He then retweeted a false claim that the Sun lied about the age of someone claimed to be a child migrant, which prompted the Sun to suggest he should be sacked. Now, I mean, I don't think he should be sacked, but I also don't think Lily Allen should have been kicked out of a black cab today by a driver who said, why don't you get an immigrant to drive you? Because she stuck up for refugees as well. What do you think, though? Should Lineker have been sacked?
No, he's the greatest... Oh, I love Lineker. He never got a yellow card, Adam, in his whole career. He scored 49 international goals. He's got lovely eyes. He's amazing. Who Also, it was a tweet. It's not like he, you know, he wasn't tweeting for the BBC. It's not like he was on Match of the Day.
Yeah.
And halfway through, he just looked down the camera and went, "You're all racists." Anyway, at the Riverside, Middlesbrough were looking for three more points. Like, I don't know. I think he should be allowed to express his opinions on Twitter, but what's happened is the reason why I would never express an opinion on Twitter, and I only tweet about having a cup of tea or going to Oaxaca. Although I do get a lot of abuse from the coffee set.
But, you know, this is kind of what Josh said is, all Lineker's done is he's kind of he's expressed an opinion.
Yeah.
And the thing with kind of, you know, the migrant crisis is the same as kind of similar that's what happened with Brexit. If you kind of, you know, if you support, you know, the migrants coming over, you know, Gary Lineker got called a left-wing lovey.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily, it's not this middle ground. We don't have to operate in extremes on both sides. The same as, you know, people who are concerned about, you know, the influx of migrants get dubbed racist. Yeah. And it's like the people who say, well, everyone who voted for Brexit's an idiot. And that's bollocks. Not everyone who voted for Brexit was an idiot. And the same as not everyone who's concerned about the migrant crisis is necessarily racist. Yes, some are. But there are some people in this country who are scared. They do see the NHS struggling. They do see waiting lists going on. You know, housing, social housing, like council houses, how difficult, you know, it is to get a council house. And they do, they're just concerned about kind of, you know, this,
yeah,
I don't know, the struggles that we have. And kind of the newspapers stir up this honeypot, and you get extremes, you know, if you express an opinion, you get people, you know, I think we should have migrants coming over, you get people saying, well, why don't you take them in? And yeah. that's not the case. And I mean, I couldn't anyway. I need my spare room for when I argue with my other half. I just...
And look, there is that thing of going, yeah, but they're pretending to be younger than they are. Look at them. They're pretending to be... I mean, we've all lied about our age at some point. Do you know what I mean? I reckon most of the people angry about migrants pretending to be under 18 have pretended to be over 18 at some point in their lives to get a beer. We've all been turned away from a nightclub, taken our jackets off, then tried to get back in again. You know what I mean? That's just for a nightclub.
The irony is, Gary Lineker with his beard looks like a teenager that's trying to look older than he is.
I'm not going to criticise anybody for lying about stuff. I mean, you know, I lied about how much my leg was hurting so I could get in the wheelchair area at Justin Timberlake. I'm not...
What?
What? I'm not in a wheelchair?
No, I've...
You didn't throw someone... Oh, my leg's hurting. There you go.
Obviously, I know that case isn't the same as what the migrants are going for. I don't want to say, you know, before people on Twitter go, it's not the same as Justin Timberlake, mate. You know, this isn't bringing sexy back. It's like... But, you know,
yeah, those people
true.
On Twitter are idiots. Oaxaca's rubbish. Fuck off.
We've all told a little white lie. We've all lied about our age. Sometimes to ourselves, Adam.
Oh, sorry.
Did you just turn into a teenager?
Well, I'll tell you what, if you've been watching X Factor over the last few weeks, you'll know that under the right circumstances, British people are more than happy to embrace someone in their late 30s acting like a teenager. I am referring, if you don't know, to the cringe-inducing musical sensation Honey G, who looks like this. When I say honey, you say G. Honey, honey. When I say honey, you say G. Honey, honey.
Oh, my word.
I mean, we think this country is a great place for people to come, don't we?
I preferred her sister Gina G.
Oh, my God!
Also, her brother Warren G and Kenny G, they're all great! The G family, she's the worst of the lot!
Now, if you don't know, she's 37, so when she does it, it's fine, but when a guy fleeing a war zone dresses up like a teenager, it's not. Here's a tip, if you're coming from Syria, dress like her, bust out a rap, call yourself Honey Refugee, you might have a chance. You know what? That's how you get people. When I say refuge, you say G. Refuge.
G.
Refuge.
G.
Well done, everyone.
When I say Gina, you say G. G. No.
Look, I think if you're genuinely afraid of refugees coming to Britain, kicking you out of your house and imposing their culture on you, then that's okay, and I'm not going to criticise that. But it's worth remembering, that's what's just happened to them in their country. And look, I am aware that an Australian telling you how to deal with refugees is like a German telling you how to craft a joke. But I think Alex is right. There's a lot of fear associated with this, and some of the press are fanning that fear, especially when you look at headlines, you know, like this. But we don't have to get angry at these headlines. In fact, it's probably best that we don't, because on the one hand, migrant madness could be seen as a reason to keep all refugees out of Britain. On the other hand, though, Migrant Madness could be a fantastic tribute act just waiting to happen. In fact, ladies and gentlemen, I give you Migrant Madness!
Did that just happen?
Yeah. Are we going to still be able to come to work next week?
By the way, if you think that was weird, just be thankful we didn't go with Honey Refugee. Let's bring out tonight's first guest. She's an actor and comedian who co-stars in the sitcom Man Down and recently appeared in the new David Brent movie. She's Roisin Conaty. Now, Roisin, I want to start by bringing up a tweet that you sent during the week. It said, can I buy this if I pretend I like it ironically, but secretly I love it with all of my damn heart, and then had this photo attached.
Yeah.
Did you buy it?
Yeah.
Did you?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Oh. Because, well, this is... this is kind of pointless.
No!
There's two of them.
You can frame the toilet.
Did you actually buy it?
I bought it.
Oh, you've got two now.
That's amazing.
Did you see my tweet in the week about the Mercedes?
I can't believe that porcelain horse sales have gone up this week.
It'd be easy to make something like that look cheap, wouldn't it? But it's lovely.
It's really great.
It is, yeah.
Ah.
Oh, thank you. What a lovely gift.
I assumed you hadn't bought it. I didn't know.
Hello.
Really? Is that your thing?
What? That's not my thing, no.
I didn't assume you'd already acted.
I want to read another tweet that you sent before the EU referendum that turned out to be quite prophetic. You said, you know how annoying the admin is after a breakup with one single person? Imagine how much there is when you break up with a continent. Right. With all of the admin that's going on at the moment, that kind of ended up being true.
Yeah.
How are you feeling now after the...
Great. No.
after the breakup.
Brexit's just, you know, it's just... I mean, first of all, I didn't realise the word was going to be around for as long. so, like, Brexiters and there's Brexiters. So we need to clear that up for a start. Another referendum, please. Yes, please.
That's what we need, another referendum.
There was good Brexit news this week. The economy grew slightly since the referendum. Nissan announced they would continue to make cars in Sunderland. However, today, Morrison's announced they're raising the price of Marmite by 12.5%. It's all kicked off. I know. I mean, pretty soon we're going to need a referendum on breakfast. And staggeringly, we've made that joke about people saying Brexit and breakfast. Labour's John McDonald made the same Brexit error this week that seems to be catching on.
The government is hurtling towards a chaotic breakfast that will damage our economy and hurt the poorest, the most vulnerable, most of all.
I think a chaotic breakfast is like when you go on holiday and you're all inclusive and you have like a jalapeno omelette and an ice cream.
Even like just two cereals. I love mixing the cereals. Frosties and Ricicles. Frosticles, yes, please.
So while he did that, Jeremy Corbyn referenced the sitcom Blackadder as he compared Theresa May's Brexit strategy to the character Baldrick when he said, our cunning plan is to have no plan. I'm pretty sure Jeremy Corbyn's just going to spend the next few years going, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there? Are you a fan of Jeremy Corbyn?
I think he's a decent human being.
this isn't going to end well.
Are you about to jump, Jeremy Corbyn?
It is definitely you. I just think he's not very... I mean, you know the day of the Tory conference, he was... photographed in Hadrian's Wall in an upcycle shop holding a recycled jumper. Like, so the Labour, you know, the Tories are nicking his act, basically. And he'd go, maybe have a PR campaign ready on that day. And he's like, no, I'm going to Hadrian's Wall.
And he was just buying a jumper.
Yeah, he just put a second-hand jumper, and that was his output on the day. And he thought, you make it difficult, Jezza.
I do like the comedy catchphrases are working their way into politics, though. And in fact, I think that's going to be our poll for tonight. What comedy catchphrases should other politicians use? Tweet them to us at the last leg. Use the hashtag lolitics. That's right. Oh, lolitics.
I'd quite like to see Jeremy Corbyn, next budget, just turn around to Philip Hammond and call him a briefcase wanker.
Garlic Brexit.
Garlic Brexit.
Can't do the accent, but...
I would like to see him at some point just go, don't mention the war. Tony mentioned it once, but I think we got away with it. And you know what? Considering Only Fools and Horses has often voted the most loved British sitcom of all time, I reckon the best thing Jeremy Corbyn could do right now would be this.
So in conclusion, the Right Honourable Lady needs to go away, check her facts, and come back to me when she's got a plan. Play it cool, Jez. Play it cool.
We'll be back with more of The Last Leg in a minute. Jeremy Paxman joins us to trawl through the US election. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to Last Leg, where we're still joined by Roisin Conaty. It's time to use the joke box to choose the next topic of the night. Let's fire it up again.
Do the gorp impersonate the...
Oh! The...
Best battle, that is,
I think.
Although, it did get annoying. Love that battle.
Really?
Battle. Yeah, it just got annoying when people kept shouting, they're behind you, all the time.
Do you know what? I didn't even really want to tell that. No, I don't deserve it.
You know what, Adam? I don't think we can do it after that joke.
No, I think
I bottled it halfway through.
Can I give it a... There you go. Right. that's better. Now, according to which poll you read this week, the US election is either a shoo-in for Hillary Clinton, too close to call, or the future is orange. thankfully, we have one man here who knows more about it than we ever will. Would you please welcome broadcaster and author Jeremy Paxman? Before we even start on the US election, there has been big breaking news in the last hour. The FBI have announced they are investigating more emails of Hillary Clinton's. Turns out, I mean, this is the ridiculous thing, they weren't investigating her, they were investigating a guy called Anthony Weiner.
Yes. Yeah. Of whom the less said, the better, I think.
Exactly. He had already been in trouble for texting a photograph of his penis to someone.
As you do, of course.
Of course. I mean, he was now being...
Does that get you in trouble?
Yours would.
He is... I mean, I never thought I'd say this. Paxman's here, the party's starting. Now, he was being investigated because he was also sexting a 15-year-old. So they were going through his emails. They found more emails from Hillary Clinton. They don't know whether or not there's anything substantive in the emails, but they hadn't been covered before, so they're now looking into these. This has become a huge thing. Donald Trump has sent out a press release already that is happier than a tablecloth on Christmas Day. He is so ridiculously excited about this. Meanwhile, Bernie Sanders is on a treadmill going, I'm here if you need me. I am here if you need me. Trump has already been quoted as saying, turns out the system might not be as rigged as I thought.
Oh, my word.
Yep.
No one likes a bad winner, do they?
And then sent out a tweet. I mean, summed it all up in this tweet. The top aide to Hillary Clinton and the wife of perv Anthony Weiner was a major security risk as a collector of info. So it turns out that a man who was sending photos of his penis to young women may be the reason that a reality star becomes the next president of the United States of America. Jeremy, what on earth is going on over there?
What are you going on about, really? This is absurd. Of course, the FBI went through 30,000 emails last summer.
Yep.
They concluded 110 of them possibly had some classified information in them.
Yep.
And they also concluded that no reasonable prosecutor will bring a case on the basis of those. So I don't think there's any evidence at all. You and Trump, well, I wish you well together. His hair and your beard, it's a great combo.
There are some reports that the polls have swung already 4% back in Trump's favour.
Look, if you believe polls, you believe anything. They got Brexit wrong, they got the Scottish referendum wrong, they got the general election here wrong, and there's no reason to assume they're any better in the States.
So here's my question. How has America ended up with those two as the candidates?
I do not know, but it's crap. Amazing, this country of over 300 million people ends up with the most god-awful choice. Hillary Clinton is a terrible candidate and Donald Trump is nuts. What else is there to say?
And
I tell you what, we should be very glad that we have the system we have in this country, because Donald Trump wouldn't survive 5 minutes here.
So why do you think Hillary Clinton's so bad?
Because she's dull. Because she's failed to articulate...
You haven't seen her in the emails I have, mate.
Are they the ones you sent pictures to? Because I thought she looked rather appalled. But anyway... as you would, of course. But no, I think she's dull. She's failed to articulate a picture of what America would be like if she became president. She exudes an air of entitlement. She looks complacent. I think she's a pretty dull candidate.
And
really.
You've interviewed her, haven't you?
Yes.
Right. And you kind of flirted with her during
the... Yes, I did. I confess to that.
You didn't say all that to her, did you? I think you're extremely dull.
You were naked.
I tell you what, I didn't text her a photo either.
Someone by the name of The Atlantic Vamp said, is it okay Eric Trump proudly stood next to a woman wearing a Latina Contra Trump T-shirt at a rally? Now, while the son of the Donald posed happily for this photo, next to a lady in a shirt that translates as Latinas against Trump, the big man himself brazenly stood in front of signs saying blacks for Trump that were clearly being held by white people. I mean, that could only have been worse if those hands were under a white sheet and the word black was spelt with three Ks.
Are you sure they're not just talking about the outdoor clothing shop?
I may have misunderstood.
There's one out of shot with Mountain Warehouse for Trump.
The Clinton campaign also came under fire for allegedly sending their own people to Trump rallies to stir up violence in a practice known as bird dogging.
Bird dog?
Bird dogging.
There's people there in a car flashing their lights. nothing's happening.
I know too much about this, I think.
But they invented the name.
Bird dogging.
Yeah, but like you sort of say, that's the thing that they're doing, and then they go, what should we call it? I've got it. Bird dogging.
What we call heckling?
It's kind of heckling.
Get on with it!
Yes, it's...
Get on with it! Come on!
Answer the question! The great thing
great
is...
Great bird dogging.
bird dogging from Paxman.
Is it standard practice? Because the bird dogger in question...
Oh, for heaven's sake, get to the point.
You are my favourite guest ever. Talking to Roisin.
What are your thoughts on
you
the election,
are my
Roisin?
Favorite girl. Sorry.
I felt like Hillary was acting like she'd won the last few days, and yeah. I felt like it was that bit in a horror film where someone sort of stabbed the monster, but they haven't left the house, and you're like, leave the house. And now this has happened. I'm like, right, brilliant, yeah.
There were rumors.
You are my favorite guest ever.
A lot of people were saying that. The presidential campaign that he was running was terrible, but if he was going to start a cable TV network, this was exactly the right thing to do. A lot of rumours that Trump TV was going to pop up if he lost the election.
It works, because, like, David Cameron...
Yeah.
That Dave, it's gone from strength to strength.
Give me my horse!
I'm really looking forward to...
You're such a siren to your jokes.
I'm hoping Trump TV does take off, because I'm looking forward to 2.5 men and a woman who's a 9. or I'm a Mexican, get me into here.
Get on with it, come on.
Chicago grope, anyone? Right. Trump said this week, though, he has no interest in setting up Trump TV, then immediately launched a live TV show on his Facebook page. It was called Trump Tower Live. It was hosted by his campaign advisors. And although around 50,000 people tuned in to watch, clearly no one told the hosts that they had started, because this is genuinely the first few seconds of the show.
What's going on?
Give him a second, boys. Sorry.
Yep. 10 seconds.
All right.
Okay.
9, 8, 7.
Happy
All right. All right, welcome into Trump Tower Live.
I mean, it's just like here, isn't it?
Later highlights included a Skype call coming in live on air.
And we've seen some pretty incredible data on, you know, the words that people would use to describe Hillary Clinton. Over half of Americans think crooked would be an accurate way to...
If they were using Donald Trump's laptop, they're lucky that's all that popped up. I mean, there's no rumours of Hillary TV. I'm assuming it would just be a list of emails that suspiciously delete themselves.
I think, weirdly enough, I think that Facebook is quite a good place for Trump TV because his stuff won't be the worst stuff you see on there. Like people who refer to their boyfriend as the boy. That's worse than anything you'll see on Trump TV.
Would you watch Hillary TV?
Yeah, I would do. I'd love to see her just do Jeremy Kyle every day with Bill doing a lie detector.
Some countries are loving the US elections, in particular China and Iran, who are using it as an example of how maybe democracy isn't the best option. Are they right? Do they have a point?
No.
No. Although, to be fair, Ed Balls is still in Strictly, so I'm not...
OK, Jeremy, what would you change about politics as it stands at the moment?
As it stands at the moment, what would I change about? Well, I mean, start in this country, you mean?
Yeah, go on.
Well, I would make it impossible to become an MP until you are over a certain age, because a lot of people just start in politics when they're about 17, 18. And the system rewards arrested development. It's really terrible, I think.
Okay.
The whole part, and don't let them serve there too long. But this is a very dull question you've asked.
No, no, we're into it.
No, we're not.
We're into it.
You want cheap laughs. I've seen this show.
Bullshit.
It's literally why I have a button.
You are the best double act I've ever seen in my life.
We did ask earlier, by the way, what comedy catchphrases should be used by politicians. Tweet them to us at the last league. Use the hashtag lolitics. Here is a quote I found during the week that best sums up the appeal of Donald Trump. See if you can pick which world leader it came from. The quote is this: I think he's representing the interests of that part of the American electorate, and it's a significant part that is tired of the same elite who have been in power for decades. Who do you think said that? World
Putin.
Leader? It was indeed Vladimir Putin, the Russian billionaire who has been in power for decades. I mean, there's a lot of talk this week we might be getting closer to World War III, what with Russia ordering new nuclear weapons known as Satan II.
I speak World War III, Satan II. It's nothing original, these. It's all secret. Isn't it? And can I watch Satan II if I haven't seen it?
I'm thinking it's a cheap last day. If you're naming something Satan II, you must think... we're the bad guys.
Well, it also assumes that Satan didn't quite work.
It's because they sailed down the English Channel with their aircraft carrier, but they also, that aircraft carrier is so old, they have to bring, like, a little boat behind it to fix it continuously. Yeah, so it's not scary, so, like, it's a shiny...
Why shouldn't they sail down the English Channel?
Yeah, but they can, I don't bother, but they've got a tiny little boat behind them that says it's...
What, you object on grounds of pollution or something?
No, I just think the whole thing's not scary. Their boat's a shit heap, and it's fine. There's no story whatsoever.
We haven't even got an aircraft carrier. We can put planes on at present.
Don't we?
No.
Oh, right. It's the penguins. Actually, I'm a tiny bit more scared now.
The thing with them going down the channel, though, wasn't that just, like, the quickest way... You know what it's like when you take... it's just the quickest way to get to where they were going.
It's a quick cut-through on a rat. Yeah. It's a rat run, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, you know what it's like with a Google map sometimes, mate. Yeah. It takes you...
They need Waze, that's what they need.
Donald Trump says the world will be a safer place with him as president because he won't antagonise Putin. Thoughts?
Oh, sensible idea, eh? If someone's threatening you, just give them a bit of your body to chew on. Really.
Here's a question for you. There's a chance that there might be a Democratic clean sweep. So the Democrats might be... Hillary Clinton might become president. They also get control of Congress and the Senate. So they get control of everything in America. Is that scarier than Donald Trump becoming president?
Well, I say not to me, because you're just speculating away, aren't you?
Yeah,
That's what politics is.
It's not what politics is. You're just... This is a ridiculous hypothetical.
Do you two want to swap seats?
I'll tell you what. I tell you what. We've been choosing topics all night. You've got a button there, a lever there. Would you like to choose the next topic of the show, please?
Of course, yes.
Thank you.
I'm hoping it's Wittgenstein.
The impossibility of happiness, leg jokes, Christmas, Game of Thrones, the Upside Down. Well, that is ridiculous. Jeremy Paxman's
honestly,
new...
he might as well be on ITV.
You have a new book out, I believe.
Indeed, Adam, you're right.
Does it look anything like this?
Like that, yes.
Just another accident.
Do you know what I like? One of the things I liked about it, that towards the end, it's called A Life in Questions. Each chapter is, has the heading of a different question. But towards the end, there's a whole bunch of questions that people ask you. One of which I thought was really interesting, and I couldn't believe people genuinely ask you if you knew all the answers on University Challenge.
Well, of course. Yeah, but it's... Of course I don't.
I know, that's what I thought. What a ridiculous question.
The last guy who knew the answer to everything apparently died in 1729.
Right.
Unfortunately, that's too old even to be a University Challenge presenter.
Do you get asked to quiz nights now because people think you know
everything?
Yeah,
but you don't want to do that. Well, you've run quizzes in Australia.
I used to have a quiz show in Australia.
If such a thing is imaginable.
Yes. He just mugged you right off.
All right, now listen.
I like you.
Thank you, thank you. Jeremy, you may have come.
Such an arse crawl.
Ironically, that was the name of the quiz I hosted in Australia. Now, I think you might have competition this Christmas. You've got your book out. The competition might come from the slightly surreal and mildly arousing 2017 Vladimir Putin calendar. That's the cover.
Whoa.
There you go. There is. We're not making these up. These are genuine shots of Vladimir Putin.
Is he checking the time with a big clock?
Yeah, that's...
Also, that one with the cat, if you don't want to be seen as, like, a scary kind of baddie, don't photograph stroking a cat. Yeah.
Well, listen, I was a little bit worried on your behalf that it might push you out of the market, so using some of the photos from your book, I've got the 2017...
you are such an arse crawler.
I cannot say how thrilled I am.
Really?
I'll see you later.
Oh, there's more. I mean, that's just the cover. I mean, let's go through. there he is. I think this is my personal favourite. That's my favourite of all the Paxmans.
Yes. I'm thrilled.
Thank you very much. We'll be back with more.
I love that.
Yeah, that's all we've got. We'll be back with more in the last second and minute as we catch up with you, Kip. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to Last Leg, where we're still joined by Roisin Connerty and Jeremy Paxman, who, during the break, has been suggested as the new host of the Great British Bake Off. I mean, would you do it? Would you consider it?
Of course. Of course.
Do you want to do a trial
perhaps
one?
We could be the Mel and Sue, you and me.
Oh, this is good. I can see
you'd
that.
You'd have to shave that beard, I think.
I can just see me going, I think that's a lovely cake. Oh, you arse licker!
Adam, the word is arse crawler.
Now, while the US presidential race hots up, the race to be the new leader of UKIP simmered away gently. After Diane James dropped out as leader and Stephen Wolfe was literally knocked out of the race, a few new nominees have stepped forward, including John Rhys-Evans, who once claimed that a gay donkey raped his horse.
Oh, excuse me. Oh. I don't want to hear about this.
I'm covering his ears.
That's my bloody horse!
Yes.
How does he know if that story? How does he know that Donkey was gay? How does he know he's just not dabbling?
Incidentally, The Donkey Who Dabbled is my Christmas book.
let's move on. Now look.
Donkey Who Dabbled.
Can you stop holding that like that, please?
I'm covering his ears.
It looks like Paul Nuttall is probably most likely to win the leadership of UKIP, but coming in second is it Suzanne Evans? I believe, and Raheem Kassam, who's also an interesting one. Is there a future for UKIP after the Brexit?
Well, I don't know where you got those figures from. It's some bloody stupid poll you've been listening to again, I imagine.
Do you know where I got those from? I got those from the bookies, because they usually get it more right than the polls.
Yeah, at the last... At when it finally happens.
Oh, yeah, good point.
But long way out, they're not so good.
OK, so... But is
Believe me, I've lost a lot of money at the bookies.
What is... I mean, what is the...
Particularly on the length of run of this show, I but anyway, yes.
What is the... What is the future of UKIP, like, after what Brexit?
It's interesting, isn't it? Because UKIP's now got the one thing that it said it wanted.
Yes.
And it always struck me that it was a one-man band.
Right.
So, you know, Nigel Farage? Well, he's resigned three times already, hasn't he? I suppose he can resign again.
Rasheed?
Or be appointed again and resign again.
Yeah, I'm with Jeremy. I don't know what their deal is. What do they do all day? I think it's pointless. And they're going to break it down. They want to break the country into counties and towns, and eventually each person is like a sovereign state.
I think you'd love that, wouldn't you, Jeremy, being your own sovereign state?
I think it's got a lot to recommend it. And I can tell you there'd be some pretty severe immigration restrictions on Australians.
Now, Raheem Kassam launched his campaign today. He called himself the Farageist of all the candidates, as you can see from that photo. He also has a history of outspoken tweets that rivals that of Roisin Conaty. At last count, Raheem Kassam has told at least 13 people on Twitter to, and I quote, fuck off. They include rival candidate Suzanne Evans, Barack Obama, Michael Howard, the magazine Popular Mechanics... and a member of the public who he referred to as Blobby, then said, just fuck off to Greggs and leave me alone.
My favourite one is, he was talking about Benedict Cumberbatch, he just put, fuck off Cumberbatch. But I think he's living a dream, isn't that what Twitter's for? If he's only told 13 people to fuck off in the whole time he's been on Twitter, he's done a great job.
I would love to see Jeremy on Twitter.
Yeah, I'd be mad to go on Twitter, wouldn't I? I bet you blokes are on Twitter, aren't you?
And you're on Twitter.
The ladies are allowed as well.
We'll be back with more of The Last Leg in a Minute. It's Josh Greg is the internet. We'll see you in a little bit. Welcome back to Last Leg, where we're still joined by Roisin Conaty and Jeremy Paxman. Roisin has just... You are in the David Brent film that's about to come out on DVD.
Yes, very briefly, yes.
What's it like working with...
Never!
What was it like working with Ricky Gervais?
It's really fun, yeah. Obviously, it's such an iconic character. So when I saw him... I was only there for literally a couple of hours, but I saw him in an office being David Brent, and I got, like... It's really, like, you know, that sucked into the television moment. Like, it was great, yeah, sort of fun.
I feel the same about meeting the character of Jeremy Paxman.
Be careful, you're saying that after he's just had a piece of paper delivered to him during the commercial break telling him what his name is. It could get mean.
We have a clip of Roisin in the David Brent movie. Oh, here it is.
It's great.
Mm.
Straight in the Toblerone, hey? You're not eating?
Not since dinner.
No.
Here we go.
Yeah, come on. Party.
Hey. Hey.
Get that down, yeah.
Chocolate.
Cheers. Champagne. Cheers. Right.
Cheers. I like it here.
Take your... jackets off as well.
Oh, yeah, well, actually.
I haven't got any clean pants.
Huh?
She hasn't got any clean pants.
When's the DVD out? When is it out, do you know?
December the 12th.
Excellent work. You'll be in the next movie. Josh has been scouring the internet over the last few days. What have you found?
You're in for a treat. Mm-hmm. Do you want to see the best ever wind puppet caught in a compromising position?
Yes.
Here you go.
I mean, to be fair, that's not the puppet's fault. Someone did slip it a roofie.
Do you want...
I feel so much better about the panto one.
Yep. Do you want to see a amusing dog impersonate some wobbly toys?
Yep. Very briefly, some comedy. comedy catchphrases came in. The Miliband brothers should say it's good night from him and it's good night from me. Theresa May is taking us out, out. She's the only May in the village. Nice to see EU, to see EU, nice. That's all we've got time for tonight. Would you please thank our guests, Roisin Conaty, Jeremy Paxman, and my co-host, Josh Widdicombe, and Alex Brooker. Next week, we'll be joined by comedians Vic and Bob, but after showing you a few clips of Trump TV earlier in the show, we'd like to leave you with a preview of the upcoming UKIP TV, starring leadership candidates Raheem Kassam and John Rhys-Evans. Thanks for watching The Last Leg. My name's Adam Hills. See you next week for The Next Leg.
Welcome back to UKIP Catchphrase. We're still joined by Raheem Kassam and John Rhys-Evans. Hey, fellas, watch your screen. Here's your first catchphrase. This is the White House, and that's a seal. What type of seal is it?
Raheem.
Obama. He can fuck off.
Well, he is. Good, Raheem, but not right, OK? The answer is the presidential seal. Close. Watch your screens. Here's another catchphrase. It's a fat lady. The opera's almost over. She's singing, what's the catchphrase? Raheem again.
Fuck off to Greg's, you blobby bitch.
Raheem, it's good, but it's not fucking right. The correct answer is, the show ain't over till the fat lady sings.
What was that?
Watch your screens. Here's another one. John.
Horses for courses.
It's good, but it's not right wing. It's a gay donkey raped my horse. That's all we have time for from UKIP Catchphrase. Good night.